God created man and woman. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and rule over it. I give you all the seed-bearing plants and fruits of the trees for food." A new world. The memory verse is from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. It says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." Today's message is, "God is love," is written upon all He has made. Have you ever been in a very dark place? No light anywhere. That is just what it was like when God began to create our world. God looked at the dark, watery space. It was time to put His plans for earth into motion. Then God said, "Let there be light," and suddenly there was a bright light. God separated the light from the darkness. He called the light day and the darkness night. This was the first day of creation. God looked around. Water covered everything. He spoke, and the waters divided, forming the sky. This was the second day of creation. God looked at the watery world. He said, "Let the water under the sky be separated, and let dry ground appear." As He spoke, it happened. God called the waters seas, and the dry ground land. God looked at the land and the seas, and He saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds." And it was so. God looked at the plants and the trees and saw that it was good. This was the third day of creation. God looked up at the sky. "Let there be lights in the heavens to separate the day and the night," He said. "They will light the earth and mark seasons, days, and years." God made two great lights. The sun was the brighter light to shine during the day. The moon was the weaker light to shine at night. God also made the stars. He looked at the sun, the moon, and the stars and saw that it was good. This was the fourth day of creation. God said, "Let the seas and the rivers be filled with living creatures. Let birds fill the air with their songs." God looked at all the creatures that live in the water. He watched the birds. "That's good," He said. God blessed them and said, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the seas, the rivers, and the sky." This was the fifth day of creation. God said, "Let the land produce living creatures, livestock, creatures that move along the ground, and wild animals." God looked at them and saw that they were good. Then God said, "Let us make people in our image. They will rule over the fish of the sea, the birds, the livestock, the animals that creep on the ground, and all living things." God created man and woman. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and rule over it. I give you all the seed-bearing plants and fruits of the trees for food. I give every creature every green plant for food." God looked at everything He had made, and it was very good. This was the sixth day of creation. God made the world in 6 days. When He finished making it beautiful, He gave it to Adam and Eve to care for. God still gives us wonderful gifts today because He loves us. When we see the wonderful things in nature, let's remember that God's love is shown by the things He has made. In the image of God. The memory verse is from Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. It says, God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Today's message is God surrounds me with his gifts of love. God created a beautiful and perfect world in 6 days. Then he created two very special people to enjoy it. Let's read about it. God had created the sun and the moon. He had created the plants, fish, birds, and animals. He looked at everything and saw that it was good. But his creation was incomplete. It was time to create people. Making people would be different from making the creatures and the plants. People were to be in God's own image, and they were to rule over the animals. So God formed a man out of the dust of the ground. He carefully made the man's fingers and toes, his eyes, ears, and mouth. When God finished modeling the man, he blew into the man's nose. The man began to breathe. He opened his eyes and looked around. God smiled at the first man and called him Adam. There was a lot to do that day. God told Adam that he was in charge of all the animals. His first job was to name them. Adam probably laughed when he saw the monkeys hanging from the trees, chattering to each other. He may have grinned when he saw the elephants with their long trunks and big flapping ears. He probably stopped to pet the shy deer and play with a black bear. God said, "It is not good for Adam to be by himself. I will make a mate for him." Adam had probably noticed that he was by himself. He may have noticed that all the animals had a partner. They had creatures like themselves to keep them company. They could communicate and share things, but there had been no one for him. So God made Adam fall into a deep sleep. Then he took one of Adam's ribs and created a woman. When Adam woke up, God brought the woman to him. Adam was pleased. He said, "She was made from my bones and my flesh. She will be called woman because she was taken out of man." And Adam called the first woman Eve. At the end of the day, God looked at everything he had created. He saw the plants, the trees, the fish, the animals, and Adam and Eve. It had been a good day. And God said, "This is very good." The best day. The memory verse is from Genesis chapter 2, verse 3. It says, "God blessed the seventh day and made it holy." The message is, the Sabbath is God's special gift to us. Have you ever looked at a gift you once received and couldn't remember who gave it to you? When God created the world, he knew that there were so many exciting things to do that people might forget who gave them all this wonderful creation. They might even forget him. So he gave them one more special gift. This is how it may have happened as God told Adam and Eve about it for the first time. It was near the end of the sixth day of creation. Adam and Eve met with God under the shade of the tree of life. "See the sun setting?" God may have asked. "I love the way the sky turns pink and orange and red when the sun sets, don't you?" As they watched the sun set on their first day of life, Adam and Eve listened to God. "When the sun sets, another day begins," God explained. "This sunset begins the most special day of all. Everything made in this earth is a present for you. There are so many beautiful and interesting things. It will take a long time for you to discover them all. But the best present has been saved until now. It is the present of a day, the seventh day. It will be called Sabbath, a day named Sabbath? Adam and Eve wanted to know more. God explained how happy He and Jesus and the Holy Spirit were with everything. As you have children, and your children have children, and learn more about this world, things will get very busy. We want to be sure that you will have enough time to spend with us. We want you to remember that we made this whole world just for you. We put a special day at the end of every week. It is a holy day that will be different from all the other days. It will be a time to stop thinking about all the things that will keep you busy on 6 days every week. You will be able to spend a whole day with us. We can only imagine what happened on the first Sabbath morning. Maybe God called Adam and Eve to the shade of the tree of life. Maybe they heard God say, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy," the very first time He ever said it. Maybe the angel sang for them and played wonderful musical instruments. Maybe God told Adam and Eve about how much He had enjoyed planning this beautiful world. What a wonderful day! Adam and Eve spent every minute with the wonderful God who had created them. They enjoyed the beautiful earth they could see in every direction. God must love us very much, Adam and Eve probably said to each other. Only someone who loves us could make everything so perfect. His love just fills us with love for Him. Every Sabbath in Eden, Adam and Eve visited with God. Every Sabbath, they remembered again how He had made the world for them. They remembered how He had made them and how much He loved them. We can be with God for a whole day each Sabbath too. God wants us to enjoy this special day He made for us. He wants us to enjoy being with Him and learning more of His love. Hiding from God. The memory verse is from 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. It says, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." Today's message is God still loves us and will forgive us if we are truly sorry when we do something wrong. Have you ever done something wrong and been afraid to say that you did? Adam and Eve must have felt that way. It probably happened like this. Adam and Eve were happy in their garden home. The best part of the day was the evening, when God often came and talked with them face to face. On the seventh day Sabbath, they spent the whole day with God. They probably never wanted Sabbath to end. God told them to enjoy every tree in the garden except one tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He said, "You must never eat the fruit. If you do, you will surely die." One day, Eve was walking through the garden and came near the tree. As she looked at it, a beautiful creature, a serpent, began to talk to her. "Is it true God has told you that you can't eat from any tree in this garden?" the serpent asked. Eve knew she should go away from that place, but she didn't. Instead, she answered the snake, "God told us we can eat from all the trees in the garden except this one. We are not to eat its fruit. We are not even to touch it. If we do, we will die." The snake answered, "You won't die. You will be as smart as God is. Eating the fruit will make you wise." Eve reached out and touched the fruit. Nothing happened. Then she took some fruit and bit into it. It tasted good. She picked more and gave it to Adam. When he knew Eve had eaten some, he ate some too. As soon as Adam took a bite, something happened to them. They realized that they were naked. They were ashamed and afraid. they knew they had done wrong. They ran to a fig tree and used its leaves to cover themselves. That evening, when they heard God walking through the garden, they hid. They were ashamed to meet him. When God found them, he asked, "Why are you hiding?" "We heard you in the garden," Adam told God, "and we were afraid." God knew what they had done, and he was sad. They would have to face the consequences. He told them that they would have to leave the beautiful garden. They would begin to get old and eventually die. Life outside the garden would be hard. Weeds would grow. There would be thorns. They would have to work hard to grow their food, and everything else would die too, the plants and the animals. Even though Adam and Eve had chosen to disobey him, God did not leave them alone. He told them about his plan to make things right. He would send his son into the world. His son would die and take the blame for all the things they did wrong. Adam and Eve were very sad and very sorry for what they had done. God forgave Adam and Eve for disobeying him. He will forgive you too when you do wrong, if you ask him, and if you are really sorry. He wants to help you do what is right, and he wants you to be ready to go to heaven when Jesus comes again. When the Crocodiles Missed Dinner. The memory verse is from Psalm 150, verse 6. It says, "Let everything that has breath praise the Lord." Today's message is we worship God when we thank him for his protection. Have you ever found a really good hiding place when playing hide and go seek? A place that no one else would think of looking? That was the kind of place that Moses' mother was looking for. Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, was worried. "What can we do about these Israelites?" he asked his advisors. "There are too many of them, and they are so strong. They might even try to join with our enemies if there's a war and fight against us." It was finally agreed that Pharaoh should give an order. All Israelite baby boys should be killed. Jochebed and Amram were frightened. They did not want their baby to die, so they decided to hide him. For 3 months, they managed to hide baby Moses at home, but soon he began to make too much noise. Jochebed was afraid that the soldiers would find him. "We'll put Moses in the river," said Jochebed. "We'll put him in a basket covered with tar so that it will float. I will watch nearby and make sure nothing happens to the basket," Miriam, Moses' big sister, may have said. Jochebed carried her son to the river in his basket. She placed the basket into the water where the reeds grew so that the basket couldn't float away. Miriam watched the little basket to be sure her brother was safe inside. And Jochebed prayed that God would protect Moses. When Pharaoh's daughter came to the river to bathe, she saw the basket. "What is that in the reeds?" she asked her servants. "Please, bring it to me." Soon the basket was delivered to the princess. She lifted the lid and looked inside, and baby Moses began to cry. The princess smiled and said, "This is one of the Hebrew babies. I will not let him die like the rest. I will keep him and bring him up as my own son." Miriam heard. She hurried to the princess and asked, "Would you like me to find a Hebrew woman to take care of him for you?" "Yes, please. That would be good," said the princess. Miriam ran quickly and got her mother. When Jochebed arrived, the princess smiled. "Please, take this child and take care of him for me," she said. "I will pay you well, and I will send for him when he is older." Jochebed was so happy. They could keep their baby, and they would even be paid for taking care of him.
"This is a miracle," declared Amram. "God must have a plan for this baby." Yes, Jochebed replied. We will teach him everything we know about the God of heaven. He must know all about God before he goes to live with the princess. The princess left Moses with Jochebed, and all the years they had Moses, Amram and Jochebed taught him about God and about his people. But the day came when Moses had to move to the palace. Moses learned many things there, but he never forgot God. When Moses was 40 years old, he saw an Egyptian beating an Israelite. He became so angry that he killed the Egyptian. The next day, Moses saw two Israelites fighting. He stepped between them and told them to stop. They turned to him and asked, "Will you kill us too?" Moses became frightened. He had done a terrible thing by killing the Egyptian, and Pharaoh might have him put to death because of it. So Moses ran away to the land of Midian. God was still with him and protected him. God had a special work for Moses to do. Time in the wilderness of Midian would help prepare Moses for that work. God watches over you too. Do you think he might have a plan for your life? The fire that didn't go out. The memory verse is from Exodus chapter 3, verse 5. It says, "Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground." Today's message is we worship God when we are reverent. Have you ever enjoyed sitting by a campfire or by a burning fireplace at home? If you do not add wood, the fire will go out. In our story today, Moses saw a fire, but it did not burn anything, and it did not go out. It had been 40 years since Moses had run away from Egypt. He now knew that he had been wrong. Killing was not part of God's plan, but God had not left him. He had protected Moses as he traveled over the desert. Moses remembered the first evening in Midian. While he had rested near a well, some shepherdesses came to draw water. They always watered their animals at that well, but some shepherds came and tried to chase the women away. Moses saw what was happening. He protected the women from the shepherds. Then he drew water for the women's sheep. The women took Moses home with them and fed him. Their father, Jethro, hired Moses to work for him. Later, Moses married Jethro's daughter, Zipporah, one of the shepherdesses, and now he and Zipporah had two sons. The Pharaoh Moses had run from was dead, but the Israelites were worse off than ever. The new Pharaoh was more cruel than the old one. How Moses wished he hadn't taken matters into his own hands. He wished that he hadn't killed that Egyptian. If only he had waited for God to show him when to act, his people might have been free by now. God knew that Moses was ready to lead the Israelites. He had learned to be humble. He had learned to wait for God. He had learned patience as he took care of sheep. One day, Moses was caring for his father-in-law's flocks as usual. Suddenly, he saw a bush burning. Moses saw that the bush kept burning, but it didn't burn up. The fire was not going out. He decided to have a closer look. As he stood before the bush, he heard a voice. "Moses! Moses!" the voice said. "Here I am," Moses answered. "Do not come any closer. Take off your shoes." "You are standing on holy ground," said the voice. "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and of Jacob." Quickly, Moses took off his sandals and bowed low. The voice continued, "I have seen the trouble of my people, and I want you to go to Pharaoh and tell him to let my people go."
"But Lord, who am I to go to Pharaoh?" Moses asked.
"I will be with you," God promised. "When you leave Egypt, you will come back to this mountain and worship me."
Moses answered, But what will I tell the Israelites? Who will I say sent me? God replied,
Tell the Israelites that the God of their fathers sent you. Tell them that I know what is happening. Tell them that I have sent you to rescue them. They will listen to you. I know that the king of the Egyptians will not believe you, but that will give me a great opportunity. I will do many signs so that everyone will know that I am the true God.
Moses loved, honored, and respected God. Although he felt unworthy, he would do what God had said. By his deeds, Moses would worship God with true reverence and respect. You too can worship God with reverence and respect. 9 times no. The memory verse is from Psalm 103, verse 2. It says, Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Today's message is we worship God when we trust him in every situation. Charlotte and her older sisters were playing outside. She stood between her sisters and fell back to one sister, and then fell forward to the other. She trusted her sisters to catch her, and they did. A long time ago, the Israelites learned that they could trust God. Moses made the long journey back across the desert from Midian to Egypt. Somewhere in the desert, his brother Aaron came toward him.
God has sent me to help you, said Aaron.
Together, they would face Pharaoh. After meeting with the Israelite leaders, Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh's palace. Moses spoke bravely.
I have a message from God to you.
God says, Let my people go to hold a festival for me in the desert. Pharaoh answered, Who is this God? I do not know him, and I will not let the Israelites go.
Moses replied, Let the people go. Otherwise, God may respond with plagues or the sword.
But Pharaoh refused and dismissed Moses and Aaron. Then he told the overseers to make the Israelites work harder. Each day, Pharaoh went to worship at the river Nile. God sent Moses to the river. There, Moses said to Pharaoh,
If you will not listen to God and let the Israelites go, something terrible will happen. Water will turn into blood. All the fish will die.
Pharaoh refused. Then Moses stretched out his staff, and the river water turned to blood. But Pharaoh still refused to change his mind. 7 days later, Moses again asked Pharaoh to let the Israelites go and worship in the desert. Again, Pharaoh said no. Moses responded,
This is what the Lord says. I will send a plague of frogs. They will be everywhere, in your bed, in your food, in your ovens.
And it happened. Frogs appeared everywhere. Pharaoh sent for Moses.
Take away these frogs, and I will let the people go, he promised. Soon great mounds of dead frogs littered the country.
But as soon as the frogs died, Pharaoh changed his mind. Again, God sent Moses to Pharaoh. Again, Pharaoh said no. And Moses promised, God will send a plague of gnats. Soon, gnats were everywhere, plaguing people and animals. Pharaoh's advisors said,
This is the finger of God.
But Pharaoh would not listen to them either. Then God told Moses to go to Pharaoh when he worshiped his gods at the river. Moses asked again, but Pharaoh still refused. So Moses delivered another message.
God will send swarms of flies. The air will be black with them.
And it happened just as Moses had said. But there were no flies where the Israelites lived. So Pharaoh sent for Moses and said,
I will let your people go. Just do not go far.
And as soon as the flies disappeared, Pharaoh changed his mind again. Moses went to Pharaoh again. God says, "If you continue to refuse to let my people go," he said, "all your animals will get sick and die." The next day, the Egyptian livestock died, but Pharaoh still refused. Next, God told Moses to throw ashes into the air before Pharaoh. He did, and the Egyptians broke out in big boils and sores. But still, Pharaoh would not listen. Then God told Pharaoh to let the Israelites go, or God would send a terrible hailstorm. The hail came all over Egypt, except where the Israelites lived. When the storm came, Pharaoh admitted that he had sinned and that God was righteous. He sent for Moses and said, "I will let the people go. Just ask God to stop this storm." But when the storm was over, Pharaoh changed his mind again. God sent two more plagues. Locusts came and ate up all the green plants. Then 3 days of darkness. It was so dark that the Egyptians could not see each other, but the Israelites had light. Still, Pharaoh refused to let the Israelites go. 9 times God sent plagues on Egypt. The Egyptians worshipped the river Nile and the creatures involved in the plagues. God proved to them that their gods could not help them. 9 times God gave Pharaoh an opportunity to recognize that the God of the Israelites is the true God. And 9 times Pharaoh refused. 9 times God showed the Israelites that he was their God, that they could trust him completely. How did they know? All through the plagues, God kept them safe. Death sentence. The memory verse is from Psalm chapter 34, verse 7. It says, "The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them." Today's message is we praise God for rescuing us from sin. Have you ever played that you were a prisoner and caught somewhere? Then did you pretend to be rescued or released? For the Israelites, it was not a game. They were caught in Egypt, but God had a plan to release them. God gave Moses a special job. 9 times he went to Pharaoh and asked him to let the Israelites go. 9 times Pharaoh said no. God sent terrible plagues on the land. Water turned to blood. Frogs, gnats, and flies covered the land. Cattle died. People suffered with ugly, hurting boils. A hailstorm destroyed most of the crops, and the locusts ate what was left. During the 9th plague, it was dark for 3 days. It was so dark that the Egyptians couldn't leave their homes or even see each other. After all that, Pharaoh threatened to kill Moses if he ever saw him again. Then God told Moses about the last and most terrible plague. "There will be one last plague," God said. "After this, Pharaoh will let you go. At midnight, I will send an angel of death throughout Egypt. Every firstborn child will die. I will protect my people if they do as I command." Moses called the people together. "Israelites, come and listen to the instructions God has given us. Follow them closely and you will be safe. Ignore them and people will die. Each family must choose a perfect 1-year-old lamb. In 4 days' time, around sunset, the father in each family is to kill the lamb. Some of the blood is to be saved. Sprinkle this blood on the sides and top of your front door frame. After this, no one is to leave the house until morning. God will send an angel throughout the land of Egypt. The firstborn in every family will die, but no one will die in the houses with blood on the doorpost. The angel will pass over those homes. You must roast the lamb, eat it with bitter herbs and unleavened bread. Wear your coat and shoes as you eat. If there is any of the lamb left, burn it in the fire. If your family is too small to eat a whole lamb, invite another family to share it, but both must put the blood on the doorposts of their houses. When the day came, Israelite families followed the instructions exactly. Everyone stayed in their houses until they heard the shouts, "The Lord's destroyer has gone through the land!" The firstborn of all the Egyptians, from Pharaoh to the poorest servant, had died. Pharaoh finally agreed to do what God asked. He told the Israelites to leave the country. Everyone excitedly packed their belongings. Their Egyptian masters gave them gifts of gold and silver. The Israelites were excited. They laughed and shouted to each other, "We are free! At last, we are free!" This meal became known as the Passover. The Israelites celebrated it every year to remind them of how God rescued them from the Egyptians. Jewish people still celebrate it today. The Passover is also a reminder of the promise that Jesus will come and die for our sins. Just as the lamb's blood saved the firstborn at the first Passover, Jesus' death saves all of us from our sins. If we believe and love Jesus, we are free and can choose to live in heaven because of his death. What a wonderful God! Streams of blessing. The memory verse is from John chapter 7, verse 37. It says, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink." Today's message is we praise God for supplying our needs. Have you ever been really thirsty and not able to find anything to drink? That is how the Israelites felt when they reached their new camp and found no water. It happened something like this. It was time to move again. The Israelites were getting used to making camp. They could put up and take down their tents very quickly now. Life in the desert was very different from life in Egypt. In Egypt, they had worked as slaves, building palaces and temples. Now they were going from place to place, following God's leading. God had looked after them in so many different ways. He had protected them when all the plagues came to Egypt. When Pharaoh chased them, God had opened an escape route through the sea. As they continued their journey, God had provided manna, food for them. They could see God's presence in a large cloud in the daytime and a cloud of fire by night. The desert was an unfriendly place. It became so hot during the day that you could almost cook on the hot stones. At nighttime, the temperature was cold. You needed to wrap up to keep warm. They had arrived at Rephidim, their new camp. Everyone was tired, thirsty, and dusty after the long walk. The cattle's cries demanded water. The sheep and goats echoed that call. The donkeys brayed and stamped their feet, adding to the plea. Only the camels did not seem to mind that there was no water. They could go without it for some time. Everyone looked around, but there was no water. People began to ask each other if they had found any water. The answer was always the same: no. Soon the people began to look for Moses. When they found him, they began to complain. "Give us water to drink. We are thirsty. Our families are thirsty. Our animals are thirsty. We must have water or we will die. Moses looked sad. He knew that God would provide all their needs. They had seen God do so many things for them. Surely they must understand that God had brought them here, and he would provide water. Moses answered, "Why are you quarreling with me? Why are you putting God to the test?" The people would not listen. They just complained. "Why did you bring us out of Egypt? We're all going to die." Moses did not know what to do. He turned to God in prayer. "What should I do with these people?" he asked. "They are almost ready to stone me." God answered Moses, "Walk on ahead and take some of the leaders with you. Bring the staff you used when I turned the waters of the river Nile into blood. I will go before you and stand by a rock at Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it." So Moses called the leaders and walked ahead. He found the rock and struck it just as God had said. Water came gushing out. Enough water for everyone. More than enough to water all the animals, too. Once again, God supplied all their needs. God never changes. He still supplies our needs today. What a wonderful God. Gone Fishing. The memory verse is from Matthew chapter 4, verse 19. It says, "Come, follow me, and I will send you out to fish for people." Today's message is, "I help others learn about Jesus when I follow his example." Have you ever watched people fish? They usually sit very still and wait. Simon Peter had been sitting in his boat all night and had not caught a thing. When Jesus told him to try again, he caught many fish. This is how it may have happened. A cool night breeze blew over the waters of Lake Genesaret. Simon Peter was fishing with his partners, James and John. He tossed his big fishing net over the water. He heard a swishing sound and then a splat as it fell. Slowly, slowly, it sank beneath the surface of the water. Simon Peter checked the position of the moon and the stars to tell the time. Soon the sun would be rising, and he still had not caught a single fish. James and John in their own boat weren't catching anything either. In a few minutes, Simon Peter began to haul in the net, hand over hand. He hoped to see the glimmer of fish in the moonlight, but there was nothing. He piled the dripping net into the back of the boat. Then he began to pull on the oars and head back to shore. The sky began to change from black to pink. Simon Peter laid out his net and began to clean it. Jesus was standing on the shore, surrounded by a crowd of people. He was telling them how much God loved them. The people really wanted to hear. They crowded so close to Jesus that he stepped into Simon Peter's boat and continued to talk to the people. Simon Peter, no doubt, was happy to share his boat with Jesus. After Jesus finished speaking to the people, he said to Simon Peter, "Take your boat out into the deep water, Simon Peter, and let down your nets." "Oh, Master," Simon Peter replied, "I've been on this lake all night long with James and John, and we didn't catch one fish." He paused and thought for a minute. "But if you say so, I will try again." With a swishing sound, the net flew up into the air. It landed with a splat on the water, then sank silently. In a few minutes, Simon Peter began to pull in the net. He could not believe it. The net was full of glimmering, writhing fish. It was so full that the net almost broke. Simon Peter called to James and John, Bring your boat and help me. Soon the floors of both boats were covered with the silvery fish. Piles of fish reached up the sides of the boats and threatened to sink them. When Simon Peter saw all the fish, he knelt before Jesus and said, "Leave me, I am a sinful man." But Jesus said, "Don't be afraid. Follow me, and I will make you a fisher of men." Simon Peter, James, and John dragged their loaded boats up onto the sand and left them there. They turned away from the biggest catch of their lives and left all behind to follow Jesus. They would serve him as long as they lived. And many people would learn of Jesus because of their work. They were truly fishers of men. Jesus makes new friends. The memory verse is from Matthew chapter 9, verse 13. It says, "I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." Today's message is God invites everyone to join his family. Have you ever felt very lonely, as if no one cares about you, and that you don't have any friends? That was just how Matthew felt until he met Jesus. Then everything changed. It probably happened like this. When the Romans conquered Judea, they demanded that all the Jews pay taxes. No one likes giving money away, especially to an occupying army. Most people were angry about it. Many tried to think of ways to avoid paying the taxes. The Romans hired Jewish people to help collect the taxes, and that's how Matthew got a job as a tax collector. His job was to make sure that people paid. Soon, many of his old friends stopped speaking to him. The Romans did not really like him either. They treated him like a servant and usually ignored him. All they wanted was their money. Usually, the only people who would talk to him were other tax collectors. People used to say that all tax collectors were liars, cheats, and thieves. But there were good tax collectors and bad ones. The Romans did not pay them for collecting the taxes. They just assumed that the tax collectors would charge people a bit more. The extra money they collected was theirs to keep. So most tax collectors charged people more than they should. For some time, Matthew had heard about a man called Jesus. Even if the people didn't talk to him, they talked to each other. And while they were waiting to pay, Matthew listened to them talk. That's how he learned what was going on in the city. Jesus sounded amazing. He healed people who had never been able to walk or see. Matthew sometimes saw them running and leaping just for fun. People said that Jesus forgave sins. Matthew wondered about that. He knew he did wrong things. Could Jesus forgive his sins? Would Jesus even want to talk to him? Then something wonderful happened. Jesus was standing in front of Matthew, speaking to him. Jesus said, "Matthew, come. Follow me." Matthew did not hesitate. He got up, left everything to the other tax collectors, and followed Jesus. Matthew decided to follow Jesus to be one of his helpers. He wanted others to know, so he gave them a big party for all his friends. He wanted them to meet Jesus too. The scribes and Pharisees came to see what was happening. They saw that Jesus was Matthew's guest. They saw him eating with the tax collectors, and they were shocked. "Jesus," they said, "why are you eating with tax collectors and sinners?" Jesus looked up and smiled. "People who are healthy do not need a doctor," he said. "Only the sick need a doctor. I have not come to tell the righteous to repent. I have come to help sinners repent." Jesus' answer gave everyone hope. No one is to be left out of God's family. Everyone is welcome to join. What about you? Have you joined Jesus' family? Let the children come. The memory verse is from Luke chapter 18, verse 16. It says, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." Today's message is children like me are welcome in God's family. Can you remember a time when an important visitor came to your town? What did everyone do? Were there pictures in the newspaper? Did you stand and wave a flag? In our story today, someone very important has just come to town. It may have happened like this. Have you heard the news? Jesus is in town. Over and over, people in the town told one another the news. Jesus is here. Everyone wanted to see Jesus. Men left their work and hurried to hear him speak. Friends and families helped sick people get near him. They had heard how he had healed others. Maybe he would heal them too. Everyone was amazed as they watched Jesus with the people. They saw blind men and women see again. They laughed with the lame people who could leap and jump again. They saw mothers and fathers and children well again. Everyone was helped. No one was turned away. When some of the mothers heard about Jesus, they wanted to see him too. They wanted him to bless their children. The children were excited. They were going to see Jesus. Children everywhere loved Jesus. He smiled at them. He spoke kindly to them and told wonderful stories. He loved the flowers and other small gifts they brought him. Soon, some of the mothers hurried through the town. They called to their friends, "Come with us to see Jesus." Children told their friends, and soon many were hurrying to see Jesus. But the mothers with small children could not go very fast. It took time for the toddlers to walk. Finally, all the mothers and children reached the crowd around Jesus. They stood at the back, trying to look over all the tall people in their way. Some of the small children may have tried to crawl forward, but they could not get near Jesus. Everyone wanted to see him. It seemed as if everyone was pushing, trying to get nearer. The mothers felt as if it were hopeless. Could anyone help them see Jesus? Maybe his disciples would help them. The mothers led the children to the disciples. The disciples frowned at them. They shook their heads. "Go away. Can't you see Jesus is busy? Can't you see he is tired?" Jesus saw what was happening. "Wait," he said. "Let the little children come to me. Don't stop them. The kingdom of God belongs to people who are like these little children." The disciples and the crowd were amazed. The mothers and children hurried to Jesus. He spent a long time with them. He took the children onto his lap and blessed them. Maybe he told the mothers how much he loved the children. Maybe he talked about how they could raise their children to love God. We don't know what Jesus said to the mothers and children that day. But we can be sure that he was not angry at them for wanting to be with him. He was happy. He was glad to talk with them. Jesus always loves children and parents, and he wants you to come to him today. He wants you to be a part of his family, too. A little man with a big heart. The memory verse is from Luke chapter 19, verse 8. It says, "Here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor." Today's message is, I show others Jesus' love when I put wrongs right. Have you ever been to a parade or ball game and not been able to see very well? Maybe your father carried you on his shoulders. If so, you will understand how Zacchaeus felt when he got stuck at the back of a crowd. Zacchaeus lived in Jericho. He had one of the biggest and best houses in town. He was a very rich man, but no one liked him, because everyone believed that he cheated people and kept their money. Everyone knew about it, but no one could do anything. Zacchaeus was the chief tax collector for the Romans. The Romans didn't care what he did as long as he gave them the right tax money. So Zacchaeus probably told people that their taxes had gone up. He collected more than he should, and he kept the extra money for himself. One day, Zacchaeus heard that Jesus was coming to Jericho. He had heard a lot about Jesus. He had heard how Jesus had healed the sick, the lame, and the blind. And some said that he had raised someone from the dead. All these things made Jesus special and made Zacchaeus want to meet him. Zacchaeus had heard about the tax collector Levi Matthew. Matthew had left everything to become one of Jesus' closest followers. People talked about it everywhere. Zacchaeus wondered, maybe Jesus has something to say to me. Yes, it was the talk of the town. Jesus was really coming to Jericho. Zacchaeus decided to try to catch a glimpse of the master. He left his tax station and went out into the street. The street was so crowded, and the crowds were getting thicker. It was hopeless. Zacchaeus tried jumping up to see over their heads, but that was useless. He was so short, and no one would let him through. But he was determined. He would not give up. He must see Jesus. Zacchaeus looked up and down the street. He saw a big tree. Climbing trees was not the sort of thing grown men did, but there was no other way he could see Jesus. So up he climbed. He sat on a big branch and looked down the road. Jesus was coming his way. When Jesus reached the tree, he stopped and looked up. He saw Zacchaeus and smiled. Everyone in the crowd stopped too. They looked up and saw Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus, come down. I'm going to your house today, Jesus said, so everyone could hear. Zacchaeus could hardly believe his ears. Jesus going to his house? He climbed down the tree and led the way. The crowd moved aside, but people began to mutter. How can Jesus be the guest of a sinner? They wondered out loud. Zacchaeus said, Lord, I will give half of everything I own to the poor. If I have cheated anyone, I will give them back four times as much. Jesus looked at Zacchaeus. Then he looked at the people who were muttering and criticizing him. Jesus said, Today, salvation has come to this house. This is the reason the Son of Man came, to seek and save the lost. Before Zacchaeus saw Jesus, he had begun to show that he was sorry for cheating people. Now he confessed this before the crowd. He showed that loving Jesus helped him to make things right. Jesus can help you make things right, too. Words to remember. The memory verse is from Deuteronomy chapter 11, verse 13. It says, Love the Lord your God and serve him with all your heart. Today's message is we worship God when we choose to obey him. Do your parents ever say things like, don't forget to take out the trash, or don't forget to feed the dog. They are reminding you to obey. The children of Israel were about to enter the Promised Land without Moses. What would he say to them? Moses looks longingly out over the Jordan River into the Promised Land. He is sad because he won't be going there. He pleads with God to let him enter that land with the people. But God says to Moses, "Speak no more of this. You may view the land, but you may not enter it." So Moses doesn't ask about it anymore. He accepts God's wisdom and will. But now Moses thinks about the children of Israel. Who is going to lead them if he can't? Who is going to care about them? He prays and asks God to provide a good leader. God tells Moses that Joshua will lead the people. Joshua has worked beside Moses since Aaron died. Moses knows Joshua is a man of wisdom and faith, so Moses is happy with God's choice. God has one last thing for Moses to do. Many years have gone by since the people first heard the Ten Commandments at Sinai. Most adults living now were small children then, or hadn't even been born. They could not have understood what was happening at Sinai. Few of them were old enough to know what it meant. So God tells Moses to proclaim these laws once more. God wants his people to follow his law as they settle into their new land. And so Moses calls the people together. Moses' face is lit up with a holy light. His clear and wise eyes look out over the thousands of people standing before him. These are his last words to them. With much emotion, he begins repeating their history. They had been slaves in Egypt, and God had rescued them. He reminds them of the great miracles God had performed for them. He tells how they had escaped through the Red Sea. And during all their travels, God had provided food and water. He had guided them by a pillar of fire and cloud. He tells them of the sins of their parents who had grumbled, complained, and worshipped idols. He reminds them of their travel in the desert for 40 years before they could go into Canaan. Moses also talks of the great patience and love of God toward them, of his forgiveness and grace. Moses tells them that the rules God has given them are wiser than all the rules of the other nations. They are to be an example of God's wisdom. They are to care for the other nations. They are told of the wonderful things awaiting them in Canaan. Then Moses goes over the laws with them again. He is still afraid that they will forget and stray away from God. So he reminds them of the wonderful blessings that will be theirs if they obey God. He tells of the blessings of food, happy families, good leaders, and protection against enemies. But Moses also tells of the curses of losing their land if they disobey. They will have no peace or safety, and they will live in fear and sorrow and with diseases. Then Moses closes with a song. You can read it in Deuteronomy 32. It tells of the wonderful way God had shown his love in the past, and it tells of future events and the final victory of Christ's second coming. Moses says, "Command your children to obey carefully all the words of this law. They are not just idle words. They are your life." The people are to memorize this song, to teach it to their children. They are to remember it always. It will help them remember what God has done for them. After this, Moses climbed Mount Nebo in the land of Moab. There he looked one more time into the Promised Land. And Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in Moab, as the Lord had said. Balaam and the Talking Donkey. The memory verse is from John chapter 14, verse 23. It says, Anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. Today's message is we worship God when we follow His instructions. Have you ever seen a dog do tricks? Some dogs can roll over and sit up. In our story, a man heard a donkey talk, really talk. Let's find out what it said. The Israelites were nearing the Promised Land, but the surrounding nations had tried to stand in their way, forcing the Israelites to go to war with them. But God was on their side, and each victory sent a message. Balak, the king of Moab, knew he didn't have any hope against that kind of strength. But then he remembered what he had heard about Balaam. Some said that whatever Balaam blessed was truly blessed, and whatever he cursed was cursed. If Balak could get Balaam to curse the Israelites, his army might have a chance. So he sent some messengers to bring Balaam to him. They took along a lot of gold. That was the money of their day. Balaam believed in God. He had once been a prophet, but he had become greedy and no longer served God. Yet when the messengers came, Balaam asked God for instructions. The answer came back, "Do not go with them. You must not put a curse on those people because I have blessed them." So Balaam sent the messengers home, but Balak sent more messengers with even more gold. Balaam knew that God did not want him to go. So he said, "King Balak could give me his palace full of silver and gold, but I cannot disobey the Lord." God knew that Balaam really wanted to go. So that night, God said to Balaam, "These men have come to ask you to go with them. Go, but only do what I tell you." So Balaam saddled his donkey and went with the messengers. Balaam did not see the angel standing in the road to block his way, but his donkey did. So she turned off into a field. Balaam beat the donkey to get her back onto the road. The angel appeared a second time, and the donkey moved against a wall, smashing Balaam's foot. Balaam beat her a second time. The third time the angel appeared, there was no place for the donkey to go, so she lay down in the road. It was after this third beating that the Lord made the donkey speak. "What have I done to you to make you beat me these three times?" she asked Balaam. Balaam was so angry that he answered without thinking. "You've made a fool out of me," he said. "You have ridden me for years," the donkey responded. "Have I ever done this before?" And that's when Balaam saw the angel. "If your donkey hadn't turned away from me, I would have killed you by now," the angel said. Balaam's life had been saved by his donkey. "I have sinned," responded Balaam to the angel. "If I am wrong, I will go back." The angel said, "Go, but you will only be able to say what the Lord wants you to say." When Balaam finally met Balak, he warned Balak, "I can only say what the Lord wants me to say." In three different places that day, Balak asked Balaam to curse the Israelites. But every time Balaam opened his mouth, blessings for the Israelites came out. After the third time, Balak was angry. "Go home," he ordered. "I called you to curse my enemies, but you have blessed them three times." "Didn't I tell you I couldn't do anything against the command of the Lord?" Balaam answered. "Before I leave, I will tell you what these people will do to your people." Then Balaam prophesied truly. "A ruler will rise from Israel. He will defeat the Moabites. The Israelites will destroy the city." God taught Balaam that worship involves everything you do. It is living a life that is pleasing to God. Worshiping is listening to God's voice and following His commands. It is using our voices, our speech, and our actions to honor God.
Created and produced by Falvo Fowler. This podcast is read by Frenita Buddy Fullwood for Gracelink.net. Animation and artwork by Diogo Godoy. Audio is post-produced by Faith Toh at Studio Elpizo in Singapore. The theme music is by Clayton Kinney. The audio engineer was Maurice Bailey.